folks. Good afternoon and welcome to today's Q&A session with our acting CEO, Dr. Jaco Deakin. We've got questions that have come through. Thank you very much for those folks that have sent those questions through. Baie dankie daarvoor. As julle enige verder vrae het, kan julle welkom om in te tik in die Q&A boksie. Ons het alreeds 'n delery wat hierso agter die skerms werk. Ons is besig om haar te probeer voor die skerm kry, maar sy is 'n bietjie skaam op hierdie stadium. Alreeds, yeah, I'm just going to punch you. We know you're up there. But thank you very much, Alreeds. I have to say that the background calmness really helps. When we go through processes, it's really nice to know we've got background help on that side. If there are any questions, please type them in. I'm not going to present a huge amount. We're going to give as much time as possible to Dr. Jaco Deakin to speak to us about anything that you're interested in. We've had a few questions that have come forward, and you're welcome to type more questions into the Q&A that we can handle them as we go.
There you go. Well, the first question is actually a very interesting one. So will the 2nd of November be a public holiday just after the election? That answer is no. No, you'd have to return to school. But on the 2nd of November, we're not going to write a matric exam. So they reserved that date for the IEC just to clean up and vacate the schools when needed. So that's the reason why the matric exam will only resume on the 3rd of November. So the 2nd is not a public holiday, so all of us have to return to our workplaces, but the school halls will be cleaned on that day and vacated by the IEC. So it's just for that extra time. So sorry, ons moet gaan werk. Die tweede, hierdie lang naweek is... nie te veel kuier oor die lang naweek en weggeraak nie. Gaan stem asseblief. En kyk hoe lyk die paaie, kyk hoe lyk die omgewing. And I think it's crucial that as citizens, it's our civil obligation to go and vote. So please, go and vote. Thanks for that. Speaking of the exam, Paul, that's the second topic I want to touch before I get to that Limpopo one, so you can stop the screen share for a moment. What are we going to do about load shedding? And how are we going to deal with load shedding during the exam? Obviously, it will touch on two things. When you write the exam, what's your plan A, your plan B, and your plan C? But also, when the kids and the learners and matriculants are supposed to prepare for the exam, how can we help and assist or advise them during load shedding? I mean, we just received the word that we're from load shedding stage 2, we've jumped to stage 4. And just before the webinar, I've listened to one of the energy experts, and he said we should actually be on level 6. That's the enormity of the crisis. So we can expect more sudden load shedding stages. So hoe hanteer ons dit? Meeste van ons skoolsale is nie gebou dat daar baie natuurlike lig in die saal is nie. So jy gaan eers kyk hoeveel natuurlike lig is in my saal. I don't think it's ideal to have a generator running next to the exam venue. As some of the learners will, maybe all of them will be distracted, but what can you do to bring in proper lights into the hall without having all that background noise? Number one, so that can be a plan A. Or what's the alternative? Can you quickly move those kids to maybe another venue, maybe even split them in 2 or 3 venues with the invigilators or bring in extra invigilators where there are proper light, maybe natural light, just to complete that paper. Obviously, within all the security checks and boundaries, but at least allow the learners to complete the exam. So that's normally plan A, is to get a venue from the start, be aware and be alert of the schedule for the load shedding and plan around it. Ons is in Bloemfontein vandag verras. Ek kan nie gedink vanoggend is dit ons beurt nie. Die volgende oomblik is die krag af. So dan skop die verrassing in. So make sure you have a plan A, a plan B, and even a plan C if needed. My concern is now no longer at school. I think we can manage to a certain degree at school. But what about our learners during their preparation? And that's my concern now. If there's a 4-hour load shedding period during the evening, and that's when they're supposed to prepare, maybe we should, as school community, consider different options. I don't think it's ideal to study with your cell phone light. Maar als daar alternatieve bronnen is, of die lampjes wordt bij die school gelaai en je matriculant gaan van die dingen huis toe, met die behoorlijke liggie te, beheerlichamen doen dit. Doen dit. En ons armer gemeenskappe skep dalk selfs een plek om te sê, weet ons gaan by die school vir jou een plekje wat ons sal sorg dat die kragopwekker hardloop waar jy kan kom leer. But I think for the next few months, load shedding will be part and parcel of our society. So let's do everything possible to assist the grade 12 learners. They've been through a lot. Let's help them. Ja, ook kruidelike solar liggies ook, maar dit is ook duur. Jy weet, om vir elke kind een solar liggie te gee, gaan jou al een paar rand kos. Maar as dit is wat ons moet doen, of jy kinders, dis ons leen vir julle liggies, of kom ons kry een project aan die gang, dat jy lig het om te kan leer, kom ons help hulle. Hoor, wie is die ouers in nood, weet nie alternatieve opties by die huis nie, en kom ons kyk of ons daai kinders kan help. So Paul, that's the load shedding one. The next one is a question directly from Limpopo. I'm going to answer it in Afrikaans. It's about the pressure on the system. In Limpopo and in most provinces, we have those parents who apply for school fee exemptions. And if they qualify, there's an obligation on the school. It's not a choice. You're compelled to give that exemption to those parents who qualify. And then the department is supposed to compensate the schools for the exemptions. And in most of the provinces, it's not happening because they don't budget for that. Now, the question is around the possibility of a class action. Can we take all the schools in that province and let's take the department to court? The problem is those norms and standards for school funding, to a certain extent, it's up to the provinces of what they can afford to pay. What we're doing, and there are two changeables. Number one, the number of learners that will qualify or parents that will qualify, and then the budget that's available. So to litigate on a specific amount is very difficult. What we've proposed, and we had engagement with the national department and with the minister to say, let's treat those children exactly the same as those children in a no-fee school. In other words, if your province are paying 1,680 rand per learner in a no-fee school, let's use fix that amount for the fee-paying school as well. Then we'll know the amount. If you have the number of learners, then we can litigate. Dan sit moontlik om hof toe te gaan om te sê, die bedrag is nou vas. Dis nie een bedrag wat onbekend is, wat in die begroting van die geleë het. Wat jy gaan met die vergoeding, gaan jy glad nie die volle bedrag kry nie. Selfs nie provinsies wat betaal, kry hulle maar tussen 5 en 10% wat afgeskryf word, kry hulle terug. So ek dink die beginsel van billikheid en redelikheid gaan wees, as ons die bedrag vat wat die departement vir 'n kind sou gee wat in 'n geen skoolgeldskool is, as die bedrag wat ons dan in 'n skoolgeldskool gaan gebruik. Dit beteken, as jy skoolgeld 12.000 rand per jaar is, dat jy vir daai kind net 1.680 rand gaan kry, as dit die bedrag as jy het jou provinsie betaal, maar ten minste gaan jy weet, dis 'n vaste bedrag waarop ons kan werk, en dit kom so in jou begroting en jou beplanning die ooreenkomstig kan aanpas. So ek het slegte nuus op daardie ene. Daar is nie 'n onmiddellike antwoord nie, maar ten minste van die beheerliggaam organisasies is ons op dieselfde bladsy. En tydens ons laaste vergadering wat ons met die vakbonde gehad het, is dit duidelik dat ten minste die Suid-Afrikaanse onderwysers en die SOE ons ondersteun om te sê, kom ons kry daardie bedrag van 'n kind in 'n geen skoolgeldskool as die basisbedrag of as die normbedrag. So, ek nou nie vir jou goeie nuus nie, maar ons werk aan daardie ene lang proses. Limpopo is een van die provinsies wat nie betaal nie, en die goed betalende provinsies, soos ek net nou gesê het, baie min wat daarvan inkom. Facebook, is daar enige wetgewing of korrespondensie of enig iets beskikbaar ten opsigte van afdwingbare employment equity kriteria by die aanstellings van opvoeders in nuwe poste? Daardie antwoord is ja. Die wet op indiensneming van opvoeders sê vir ons in HB artikel 7, in die artikel handel nou spesifiek oor die aanstelling en die vul van hierdie poste, so dis nou geadverteerde pos, en een van die kriteria wat gebruik moet word, is die behoefte om die wanbalansie van die verlede reg te stel ten einde die breë verteenwoordiging te bewerkstellig. So employment equity, die wet op gelijke indiensneming, het twee komponente. Die een komponent gaan dat ek nie onrechtvaardig of onbillik kan discrimineer ten iemand in een aanstelling. Die tweede komponent van daardie wet gaan oor regstellende aksie. So kom ons werk met die eerste gedeelte. As iemand aansoek doen, dan mag daar nie onbillik gediskrimineer word. Nie, die wet sê nie, ek mag nie discrimineer nie. Ek mag discrimineer, maar ek mag nie discrimineer op onbillike basis nie. Ek het een pos en 50 mense doen aansoek, so hoe gaan ek van 50 af na een toe? Ek moet discrimineer, ek moet kriteria daar stel om te besluit wie gaan die persoon wees wat die pos kry. Maar elkeen van daardie kriteria moet regverdig kan word. Kom as jy dis 'n wiskunde pos, dan gaan dit mos na een van jou kriteria wees. Want ongeag employment equity in skole, gaan het eerstens daaroor, wat is die skool se onmiddellike behoefte? It doesn't help I appoint a Xhosa or a Zulu speaker and the language of tuition is Venda at the school. So that would be the primary criteria then for that school. You should be able to teach in the language we use for learning and teaching at our school. So that's, are you going to discriminate? Absolutely. But you can justify. Then it's a fair form of discrimination. That's the first part. The second part deals with the employment equity on affirmative action. And how do you apply affirmative action? Now, on our website, there's a document on the application of the Employment Equity Act, that's specific reference to affirmative action on public schools. If you, as an SGB employer, and you employ more than 50 people in SGB posts, then you're a designated employer, and then you'll have to draw up your own employment equity plan and submit those yearly documents to the Department of Labor. But in most instances, the school will get guidance from the provincial department on the provincial posts to say, there's our preference or there's our need for the next few years in terms of the broader employment equity plan of the department. But again, then the department is evaluated as an employer. They consider all the schools. So you're not going to use the provincial formula in your school. They will be assessed on all the employees in the province. So kyk mooi daarna. As jy daaroor wonder, skakel eerder een van ons provinsiale bestuurders, kyk na die dokument en ons gesels met mekaar daaroor. Maar dis verseker deel van ons aanstellingsprosesse by ons skole. En as daar afgewyk word, natuurlik met goeie rede. As daar nie kandidaat uit 'n aangewese groep aansoek doen vir die pos nie, of daardie kandidate wat aansoek gedoen het, voldoen aan die kriteria nie, dan kan die skool regverdig waarom so kandidaat nie aanbeveel word by die departement of aangestel word as dit 'n skoolaanstelling is. Dag Jaco, goeiemôre. Die aanstelling van tydelike onderwysstudente is 'n baie goeie inisiatief deur die president en dit verlig die druk op skole en koshuise. My vraag is, wanneer sal die moratorium op die aanstelling van nie onderwyspersoneel gelig word, want dit plaas druk op skole en beheerliggame te betaal? Ek weet nie wat sy provinsie jy is nie, maar die alle provinsies het nie die moratorium nie. Ek vermoed dit kan dalk Oos-Kaap wees wat daai krisis het. Ons moet dalk gaan onderskei tussen hierdie presidensiële indiensnemingsinisiatief en die gewone onderwysbegroting. In die gewone onderwysbegroting is die provinsie veronderstel om te begroot vir opvoeders en vir nie opvoeders en dis deel van jou poste mandjie vir die nuwe jaar. Die moratorium, as ek nie seker wat die provinsie het, is nie, sal ek help as jy ons laat weet. Ek, meeste provinsies het al die moratoriums begin lig, want daar is 'n plig op die departement om ook daardie mense aan te stel. Maar selfs die provinsies waar hulle aangestel word, gee nie vir jou 5 personeellede as dit jy behoefte is, jy kraak hoogstens 1 of 2. So die las bly op die beheerliggaam. So vir die afsienbare tyd, moet hy maar begroot vir daardie post of kyk, hoe kan hy hierdie goed combineer by die skool. Ons is bekommer dat die departement eenvoudig meer administratieve laste na die skole toe stuur en skaal hulle administratief af, maar iemand moet daar die rekening betaal. So stuur vir ons vir jou provinsiale bestuurder dit deur dat ons dit verder kan opneem. Hierdie jeuginisiatief kom nie uit die onderwijsbegroting uit. The $6 billion is coming directly from that the president's campaign and that specific fund allocated for it. Let me be clear, that's not an education project. It is a social project to alleviate poverty in school communities. We've raised our concerns about the issues that we faced during phase one. I know it helped a lot of our young people. I think 350,000 people benefited. But as governors, our responsibility is towards the school. In phase two, we still struggle to get a straight answer from the department who will be the employer. I think the department should be the employer. SGB go through the interview process, make a recommendation, then they're appointed as non-educators at the school, and then the applicable legislation will be straightforward, the disciplinary process and so forth. If the SGB is the employer, then you need to be very careful about payments, because you cannot pay those young people out of your school fees wasn't approved in the budget that you presented to the parents a year ago. So the department must pay the money in your bank account first before you can spend the money. So if you're going to employ, and if the department insists that you are the employer, please use one of the FETSOS contracts on the website. We've put in a clause to say you'll only get your payment once the department have paid over the money to the school. Ek hoop nie dis weer waar nie, maar verlede jaar, 23 December, in twee provincies het skoolhoofde opdragte gekry van kringbestuurders om te sê, ons het nie nou vir julle geld nie, gebruik is op die skoolgeld om die mense te betaal. Julle mag nie, dis onwettig. Nou is die jong mense vir die skool kwaad, terwyl die departement hierdie ding gedruk het. So are really concerned. We're also concerned about the timing, if it's really to the benefit of the school. Don't appoint them for 2 months during a school holiday. Our leaders need time to rest. One of the principals said, I'm going to use my holiday to babysit those kids at school. That's not the aim. So we've got serious concerns. We've sent out the newsletter in that regard. We're still waiting for answers. I don't want to speculate about the election and so forth, but when you go into that, just be aware of all the risks. I absolutely acknowledge that there's definitely advantages for the unemployed youth in your school community. And if they can benefit, if you can accommodate, just be aware of the risk in that process. Paul, would like to come in.
Can I just add a follow-up question there, which I got from a principal. Is that program compulsory? Is it a voluntary program for school, or is it a compulsory program that you have to take a certain number of these young folks into employment processes?
Now, Paul, it was one of the questions we raised to say, well, we know the emphasis or the main aim for the project is to help the quintile 1 to 3, the so-called no-fee schools. So that's the first priority in terms of that program. We raised the issue, say it's compulsory. I think it should be a needs analysis from the school. And if the school cannot accommodate or they don't have a need, I think the SGB chairperson should write the letter to the department to say, we're not going to take part in this project. All the best for the other schools. But take your school principal out of the equation, because his employer will put pressure on the principal to say it's compulsory. But as SGBs and as SGB chairpersons, we need to take the lead to say it's possible for us to accommodate, or it's not possible, or that's the number we are willing to take. Don't be bullied. Definitely don't be bullied. If you experience pressure, if you are bullied, please call FETSOS, bel die provinsiale bestuurder in jou provinsie, dat ons dit onmiddellik kan opneem. Ek het vanoggend met die nasionale departement geskakel om te sê ons wag vir antwoorde. Ons verwag 'n baie dringende spesiale vergadering juis net hieroor, omdat ons lede baie vra het en ons kry nie antwoorde by die nasionale departement. So ek is bekommerd. Paul, I'm concerned that it is rushed again. What we see now is again a fragmented approach from national and the provinces. So a mooi project kan al baie skeefloop weer, omdat daar nie goed genoeg gedink is en nie duidelik gekommunikeer word.
Okay. Yeah, maybe I can just say, get hold of your provincial managers if you need some support. And talking about that, Michael Barker, our provincial manager from the Northern Cape, is online as well. And he just added to that discussion with regards to the moratorium, that was asked because it was in the Northern Cape. The listener identified it as Northern Cape. And Michael Barker has just said, Noord-Kaap het reeds die afgelope 5 jaar een moratorium op die aanstelling van ondersteuning personeel word gereeld by PCF bespreek. So that gives you a bit of a direct answer, the gentleman from the Northern Cape.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for that, Michael. Daar het 'n baie goeie vraag ingekom oor 'n sysnommer, en die persoon het gevra moet my nie identifiseer nie. We're not going to do that, don't worry. Can somebody without the size number stand in front of the class, even temporary? Jy mag staan voor die klas, net nie onderrig gee nie. Nee, die oomblik wat jy onderrig gee, moet jy 'n sysnommer. Let me repeat that. You cannot give independent education if you're not registered, if you don't have a size number. So the bottom line is, no, we'll be charged if there's somebody who's not a registered educator teaching the principal. So you put yourself at risk. I currently serve on a council of educators at SAIS, and I serve on that ethics committee. And I know we charge the principals for allowing non-educators to teach. Again, speak to your provincial manager, take it up with the department. There's a pool of educators that's supposed to help, but don't expose yourself in that way. Even with your student teachers, they can teach, but under the direct supervision of an educator. This is a proof student, né? Ek bied die les aan, maar die opvoeder is teenwoordig in die klas. Ek het die professionele toesig wat uitgeoefen word. So wees baie, baie versigtig. Praat eerder met die departement om 'n tydelike opvoeder te kry, maar moet onder geen omstandighede iemand wat nie geregistreer is voor 'n klaskamer sit nie. Die persoon op risiko is die skoolhoof. Paul, let me just have a look at a chat box. I don't see any.
While you're looking at that, I'm just going to share our provincial manager's details because you mentioned it a few times, and our provincial manager's details are there in front of you now. While you're just checking to see if there are any questions or anything else that pops up that you think is worthwhile us mentioning at this stage, a few weeks before the end of the year.
Thanks. Dalk wil ek net op my Noord-Kaap vraag nog 'n sterkie byvoeg. Ons uitdaging met litigasie is 'n kind het 'n reg tot onderrig, tot onderwys. So daar moet 'n onderwyser aangestel word. Maar kind het nie 'n reg tot administrasie by 'n skool nie. Ek dink dis wat dit so bietjie moeiliker maak. Nou weet ek daar was in die Oos-Kaap was daar 'n hofuitspraak daaroor gewees. Om te sê, maar daar behoort assistente en koshuisassistente en so meer ook te wees, en dis my dokument of die uitspraak wat ons gebruik om druk uit te oefen op die departemente. Maar dis gewoonlik die eerste plek waar hulle besnoei, maar om seker te maak ons het onderwysers in die klaskamer. Die ander stukkie raad wat ek kan gee vir daardie provinsie is dat ons via die onderwysvakbonde ook baie opskop, want as die administrasie nie in kantoor gebeur nie, dan om die administrasie skielik in die klaskamer plaasvind. En as daar onnodige druk op die onderwysers om skielik administrasie te doen en hulle kom nie uit by onderrig nie. So kom ons beklei hierdie geveg op meer as een front, dat die vakbonde help druk of die onderwysers help druk, sowel as die beheerliggame en ons binne daai provinsiale PCF vergaderings. Paul, I think we've answered the questions. We do have time, so if you've got more questions, as jy meer vrae het, stuur gerus vir ons in. Maar ek dink dis die warm onderwerpe. Ek het vanoggend op die radio gepraat na aanleiding van 'n studentorganisasie wat 'n brief geskryf het oor skoolklere en hoe onprakties skoolklere is. So that radio interview will be on the FEDSA's Facebook page, I think within the next day or two as a podcast. It was on RSG as a praat saam, so dis nou in Afrikaans. But just to summarize, the student leader said either the school clothes are outdated or it doesn't really cater for our needs on gender or ethnicity or whether it's either too warm or too cold. We've got stupid rules to say on a certain date you must start to wear your summer clothing, then it's still cold. And the bottom line is, it's a governance matter. Make sure that you've got open communication channels where you can communicate about special needs on your clothing. Number two, affordability. Remember the Competition Commission. There's a document on our website about the school clothing. Don't brand every single item. If there's no urgent need to brand the socks. Don't brand the socks. Probeer het so bekostigbaar as moontlik vir jou ouers aanbied. I don't think we'll reach a point soon where we say we're going to abandon the school uniforms. I don't think it's going to happen, but it should be generic enough that I can purchase from different suppliers, different qualities, obviously, but it must suit the budget of that family. And then also use your clothing bank at school. See how can you recycle secondhand clothing within your school community. So be very sensitive. And maybe the last remark before I go to questions, if there are any, is remember your budget meeting and the AGM. Maybe it's a combined meeting, but motivate your parents to be there. Discuss the issues of the day, not only the budget. Give feedback on what you've done as an SGB, what you plan for the next year, how you've operated, and also discuss your needs. That's your opportunity to engage with the parents, get the message out, raise the concerns. So that's my advice. Dit gaan jou laaste vergadering vir die jaar wees, dat die skool en die skoolgemeenskap sal weet waarmee jy besig. Ouers wat kla, is ouers wat baie gevalle nie goeie en duidelike kommunikasie kry. So in hierdie tydperk moet ou meer kommunikeer. Jy moet oorkommunikeer in plaas van te min kommunikeer. Good question. Can the AGM be online? The answer is yes. Can be online. There's a document on our website we've helped last year to say, as long as it's a meeting. Now, for a meeting to qualify as a meeting, then people should be able to hear one another, see one another. So what we're doing now is not a meeting. I'm presenting something, eh? So just when you start to open the camera so you can hear what the other people say, how they engage, then that's a meeting. Or you can even have a hybrid kind of meeting. So, well, we'll be in the school hall. We'll broadcast. You can tune in, ask your questions, listen to the questions, and then it's fine. We've also helped the SGBs with a document last year on how to amend the constitution of the SGB to make provision for the online meetings and for e-meetings, not only for the AGM, but for the ordinary SGB meetings. So yes, indeed, it's possible. Ek dink COVID's nie weg nie, nee. Die getalle is wonderlik laag en ons moet dit so hou. But most money stupid is. So if we can use technology or have a blended approach, let's do it. Paul?
Yeah, if I can just add to that, I think the schools in Gauteng that need a quorum for their finance meeting, and I don't want the other 8 provinces to panic about it, but just so that you very understand the process, in Gauteng, a quorum is required for your budget meeting. And I think with an online or hybrid process, you can actually get to that quorum. And we've been seeing it, it's been happening. So you can well get to it from that side.
Yeah. By the way, it's the only province with 15% quorum. Huh? It's the enigste ene. So the rest van julle, as in ander provincie is, yeah, 2-3 is nie helemaal lekker. En jy kon duik as 'n keer by vergadering gewees. Ek sal nie sê wat die provincie nou vraag. Wie van julle hier kan julle begrotingsvergadering in die skoolsaal hou? Of in die skoolsaal nodig soveel mense is daar? Nou steek al min hande op. Sê, wie van julle kan die begrotingsvergadering in die personeelkamer hou? Steek op julle hande. En toe ek vraag, wie kan die vergadering in die skool op sy kantoor hou, toe steek die meeste ouens lande op. So that shouldn't be the case. I mean, you need to present something that entices the parents to be there. So straightforward budget is no longer sufficient. I think you should run it as an AGM, where you give feedback, give opportunity to discuss, maybe discuss the hair or your clothing and get inputs from your school community, not only to say, let's approve the budget. You're going to pay 15% more next year. Cheers. Yeah, Paul, you've been a chairperson, and yeah. I know you need to do more to get people there.
Yeah. I always say to schools, and obviously being involved as a chairperson as well, is get the parents involved before you think you need them involved. Because when things go skip, when things do go wrong, that's when you need the parents' involvement. That's where you need their support. So, and often the argument is, oh, well, the parents are all happy, that's why they're not attending. But rather get more support, rather get them there, rather get them more aware of the process. So when you do need their support, when things do go a little bit stuck, odd shape, then you've got the parents' involvement. So don't just hope you're going to get it when you need to. Work at it when things are going well. Make sure you get them there as well from that side. A message in the chat box. And once again, just to show the diversity, Hanley Duplessis, legal officer said she'd answered the person on Facebook as well. So we are covering that base as well from that side. So thanks very much, Handi, for that. I'm responding to that from there. Jaco, I don't know if there's anything else that you want to mention in particular. It was just an open discussion session. We've had a few good questions come through. I'm quite happy if the participants are quite happy. We've answered some of those questions that are there. Great to see our provincial managers, some of our provincial managers on board. Maybe just a closing off statement or two. It might be worthwhile. If there are any questions, if you've got a long question, just say, hold on, I'm typing. We understand not everybody types like a secretary. But if you need a longer time, let us know. But if there are any questions, throw them in there, maybe while Jaco's finishing off.
Nou, Paul, ek wil net sê, ek het gister nou jou en Rian se sessie misgeloop, want ek het skoolkriket gaan kyk. Ek het vir die onder 11 kriketspannetjie gaan kyk, en ek kan nie vir jou sê hoe lekker dit vir my was. Of weer saam met 'n klomp ander ouers langs die veld te sit. Dit was 'n verskriklike groot gemis geweest. Ek kon sien hoe geniet die ouers dit, en geniet die kinders dit. Jy het met 'n masker langs die veld te sit, wel simpel, maar ek het van die masker vergeet. Het om my kinders weer te sien deelneem. And then I realized it's such a privilege to be involved at this school. It's such a privilege to be next to a sport field, just to encourage your children, just to play sport again. It really felt that we're moving towards normality. But then I also realized, for us to keep on doing that, we need to be very careful. We shouldn't do stupid things. And it's actually in our hands now. It's not in the hands of the authority. If we can do things right, then we'll be there for the rugby match and the netball and the soccer and the athletics. So I really enjoyed it. So I really want to encourage all of you, if you haven't been vaccinated, just go and do it. Let's make it safer. Let's get some normality back in the system. So thank you for your questions. Thank you for being in attendance. Thanks, Paul.
Thanks very much, everybody. Thanks for your attendance. I'm going to close the session now. Thanks a lot.
Bye-bye.